So we almost have few enough people that we could go around and just very quickly say what you're hoping to get out of this session and your name, but I'll forget that. You better remember what to get out of this. So, you want to start?
I'm Steve Baskoff. I'm from Vanderbilt, Digital Scholarship and Scholarly Communications Department, and I'm kind of a linked data guy and not an Omeka guy, but one of my colleagues is supposed to give a workshop on Omeka in a couple months from now. I thought,
okay.
Oh, yes. And maybe I can help her. And I'm interested in, I mean, I've seen Omeka, but I'm interested in like what, I didn't actually realize that it had anything to do with data, so I'm just trying to learn.
Okay, thank you.
I'm Brian Reddick from Brigham Young University. I manage IT for our library. Mm-hmm. And I would like to just see what Omeka can do, and you know, we regularly have people ask us for help with digital humanities type projects. I've heard that this might be a good choice for some of them.
Excellent. I'm glad to hear word of Omeka comes up once in a while.
I'm Robert Fernandez. I'm a librarian at Prince George's Community College in Maryland, and one of my many hats there is I'm overseeing the content DM stuff. And I'm wondering if I can something I can learn here can apply to that. Mm-hmm. Replace that. Who knows?
It's funny how people talk about replacing content DM in Omeka very often in the same sentence.
Approaches, and I don't know enough about Omeka, and I wanted to finally see it in action since I've never had the chance to workshop before, so that's why I'm here.
Okay, wonderful.
Perseus is amazing. Thank you.
Well, we have dedicated users, and
so it sounds like a sort of origin story of Omeka seems to be in order to sort of place what it is and what it does and why it does some of the things that it does and why it does not do some of the things that it doesn't do. And then I'd like to look at building sites in Omeka S, starting with items that are already in there, and then move to the item creation process, which is where the linked data material actually starts to come into play. So that's going to be the moment where I will throw it to all of you guys. I hope this will be lots of hands-on work so you can directly play around with what it does. There's a sandbox for Omeka S, so you will be able to just log right into that when we get to getting our hands dirty. Then after some time playing around there, hopefully that will get us to a good wrap-up time to talk about what you have discovered and to finish out with some of the hidden things that I might not have got to during the rest of the time.
Tell me about the S. Okay, so like there are some individual people who are not institutions who want to use us to help them with it. And so is that, we would we be using non-S for them, or?
That is an excellent question. Can I back up just
a
little
bit?
Yeah,
sure, sorry.
Oh, no, that's all good. And indeed, I do encourage you all to jump in, interrupt if I'm being confusing, something needs more explanation. I think that question works well after a little bit of that origin story. So, Omeka, not Omeka S, the two different things, Omeka was built by the Rosenzweig Center for History and New Media a little over 10 years ago. Its purpose, its target audience, was small historical associations that had really interesting stuff, but no budget to hire a IT department or to hire a developer to build a website for them. So that was sort of the original target for Omeka. Quick and easy web publishing for small institutions. This was a bit inspired by how popular WordPress was getting. Quick and easy web publishing for everyone. I generally think of Omeka as WordPress for people who love their metadata. from the beginning, emphasis in Omeka had always been, here's how to put in good metadata. So out of the box, you've got Dublin Core. Over the years, people have added more and more vocabularies. Great, move on a couple of years, and weird things start happening, like teachers of history wanted to have a course site that their students would build. Every once in a while, we would get a literature professor who, for some reason, wanted to use it to display information about the works they were reading. So it expanded out to lots and lots of different groups. And eventually, that idea of, oh, it's for people who don't have an IT department, kind of fell apart, because suddenly there were huge institutions that did have an IT department that were using it for super cool projects. My favorite example is that when the Grateful Dead went to the UC Santa Cruz Library and said, here's our stuff, do something interesting. They built up an Omeka site for the Grateful Dead archive online. That's a huge library that is now using Omeka. They built a bunch of very cool plugins for it. And it's that library part that gets us to Omeka S, because what would start to happen, especially with the professors using Omeka in their teaching, before the beginning of the semester, they'd go to their friendly neighborhood library tech department, say, hey, could you spin us up an Omeka site? Sure, we can do that. Goes great that semester. Next semester, there's three professors going to the tech department and saying, can you spin us up three more Omeka sites? I'm like, well, okay. See where this is going. Too many Omeka sites for your library tech staff to manage or update or just keep running. So the primary purpose of Omeka S was to have one installation that many sites can get created off of. So it's just push a button to create a site. Second main purpose of Omeka S is better interoperability with different systems. And that's where the linked data stuff comes from. We're seeing interoperability through linked data as being important. And so we made that decision early on to completely rewrite that original Omeka into a brand new thing with linked data baked into it. So back to the first question. For an individual, should this be an Omeka site or an Omeka S site? It depends. If the linked data stuff is important, then yeah, aim for Omeka S. If it's not as important, then the Omeka Classic might be the right thing. Because Omeka S is so new, there are fewer plugins and themes available for it. Omeka S or Omeka Classic has been around so long that there's lots available. So those are sort of the two major criteria to look at when thinking about Omeka Classic versus Omeka S. Okay, ready to go in? So, just so you can sort of see a little bit of the architecture before you, you guys get your hands dirty. Like I mentioned, it's built for one installation, but many sites. And so, sorry, I auto-completed to the wrong thing. Back to those instructions soon enough. Okay, there we go. This has a bunch of sites. So the basic workflow, once you have a site, you edit the site to add resources to it, and you basically search through all of the data, all of the items mostly that's in this installation, and from there you can start to like tie the individual items together with the site. Once you have that, once you can make those selections to make it actually display, you create a page. Just very quick, add a new page. And then build the page up with different sort of design layout blocks. And this is where you start to go through and put them in a form to actually display. Okay, went through that quickly because I want to get to the good stuff of item actual creation. Should I stop for questions before I get to that sort of next major section?
What does the S stand for?
Ooh. Depends on who you ask. The inside scoop is that when we realized it was going to be a complete rewrite of Omeka, we thought, well, we can't call it Omeka 3 because that's going to imply continuity. So have a meeting. What do we call it if we don't put a number on it? Lots of ideas came out. Eventually somebody said, S. Why not? So that's where the S came from at the center. But then lots of people, when they got into using it and saw all of the vocabularies from the semantic web world, they said, oh, those sneaky people, the S stands for semantic. Yeah. So you'll hear people say it stands for semantic. That's not truly where it came from. But what the heck, exactly. The center is a pretty easygoing kind of place. Yeah, so, how do I want to get here to the items and start by taking a look at one of these? The size makes it a little bit weird because I blew it up for presentation, but so the interface is cleaner when it's not blown up like that. So what you got here, again, start right away with encouraging double core. Please start, okay, DC terms title. Most of the time people are putting in text. Or if you have put in an item for a person, the creator, you can directly link it within Omeka S. So you have a nice tight relationship within Omeka S. Or pick whatever arbitrary URI you want it to refer to. So right there is sort of the basic mechanism to start having stuff in your Omeka S installation have data that can link out to something else. I've always wished that there were a better interface for doing that, like some kind of fancy search DBpedia or search Wikidata. I think that would be great, but at this stage, it's enter the copy and paste the URI. It comes out of the box with these three vocabularies already ready to go. And you just click on the term to start entering data. The friendly eye that we've seen a bunch of times today, same thing, just pops up the RDF comment for that term. And there's most of the metadata entry. One thing that you might predict is this can get to be kind of a confusing mess, especially for students. Here, make sure you picked the correct properties from these, what, 170 things? This is where the concept of resource templates come in. So depending on the type of item you're displaying or representing, you would sort of do a little pre-setup work to select what is going to be relevant, just to guide people towards what they need. And then the sort of non-linked open data stuff of you attach an image or you attach an audio file.
Sorry to interrupt. Is there a way to import this kind of stuff? Because instead of reinventing the wheel, so I'm looking at the sample item for Daniel Chester French. Wouldn't it be easier just to pull in the LC authority record or the Wikidata item? Is there a way to do that?
Yes and no. Unfortunately, yeah, that's going to be the kind of answer I have to give a lot. First off, you can import vocabularies. Have the RDF for vocabulary. Suck it right in. For that kind of metadata content, it is possible, but not in a generalized way. So there's not, here's the URI, and bring everything in.
Okay.
Partially because that gets to be so unpredictable. You can't know in advance, okay, what properties do I have to have already in the system?
Gotcha.
So it's possible if you create a plugin that is very specific to a data set so it knows what to do. For example, there's a module that will suck data in from a Fedora installation. So Fedora 4, happily spitting out linked data, and since it's predictable, yeah, we can create a plugin that sucks it in. So mixed bag there.
Oh, of life.
Yeah. But like I said, you can create a module that'll do it, and I hope people will do such a thing, but it was not in the scope of our grant.
Oh.
So is there any kind of enforcement of, like, on the Dublin Core terms where that's recommended to use a URI? Like I was noticing DC terms, creator,
yeah.
It's supposed to have a URI. Yeah, creator is supposed to have a URI.
Right.
So it doesn't really enforce that, though, right?
It does not enforce that. And that's sort of an awkward balance that Omeka has always tried to ride. Because it is meant as web publishing. And so there's going to be plenty of people who want to publish their stuff on the web, but just don't know what URIs are. And their standard thing about it is just, okay, I'll just type in the name of the creator. So we do not do that kind of enforcement because of that wide variety users we have of different skill levels, different metadata levels, that sort of thing. That's in Omeka Classic, that was kind of out of hand because for any metadata field, Omeka Classic lets you put in whatever you want, including HTML. So we would see occasionally disturbing things like in the description field, people would discover, oh, this YouTube video is a great description of this building. Slap in the embed code from YouTube into the Dublin Core description field. Yeah, so there's, but for a website, yeah, they want to put in the video. So yeah, I always had exactly the same reaction to that. And so yeah, it'll get a little bit awkward around here too, but that's the balance we aim for. Thank you. I keep having to remind myself it's sort of what we aimed for, but I don't work there anymore. It's what they aimed for. So this is where this also sort of leads to why we have all these different kinds of media that you can upload or that you can attach to the item. Yeah, usually it's going to be upload a file, image, audio file, something like that. But for those people who really want their YouTube to be displayed, we've sort of separated that out into its own special handling. And so that sort of opens up all kinds of options. If you have the URI to a IIIF manifest, okay, you can display that. General URL, HTML, that broadens out. And again, a module can easily add to this list. If there's some kind of resource that is special to what your project needs. Okay, so I want to make sure that there is hands-on time. So I'm going to stop there and respond to any other questions, and then give you the directions to get into the sandbox and let you dive further into creating an item, putting in metadata.
One question, I know that it uses Dublin Core as there's probably, I'm sure, an extension out there or something. Has anyone ever suggested using like a different type of metadata standard, like mod or something, or are those too high work? Or is that the huge developer community out there that someone's done that?
People have asked about that. It would make the data model just too crazy to have the data model first be RDF and then have other completely different things play well with it. The database just couldn't handle having those different data models around. So yeah, they do get that request, but the answer is always convert it to RDF and import it. That's as close as Omeka asking can get.
You said that you can reuse items that you created.
Mm-hmm.
Is that within an entire installation or just the individual site?
Excellent question. It is within the entire installation.
Oh, cool.
Because this is similar to the principle of a WordPress multi-site network. One installation, many sites. But that makes it very hard in WordPress to like share across different sites. Especially for this kind of teaching, scenario we imagined. Sharing and reuse across different sites was going to be essential. So if you're teaching the same class every other semester and want a new site for each of them, absolutely couldn't say, just re-upload everything each semester. So that's why it's shared across everything. It takes a bit more advantage of the data structure. Especially in terms of that block layout business. So that's where things get put together. So here's items, different types that are sort of built up, but it's again emphasizing on web publishing, more I think than sort of doing a discovery job. Pretty much Google, come to us and index, and that's how people find things.
But it's also under the hood, so users aren't really seeing those triples or those connections right there on that
function. No. Yeah. I think there's talk, and maybe somebody, I heard a rumor, was building a module to put either microformats or RDFA, something like that. So that's, again, possible. Just have to find the developer to build it. All the data is also exposed through the API, though. So that's another source of data. Good, excellent. So, if you're ready to dive in, if you go to omeka.org and learn more about Omeka S, scroll down a little bit and gets to try the sandbox. And there are three accounts that are in there already. You won't blow anything up if two of you log in with the same account.
I'm already logged in with one of those.
Okay, good, so we're safe. Perfect, so if you wanna dive in, play with things, I will bop around the room and respond to individual questions.
Do people share resource templates among different installations, or does everyone typically create their own?
If I remember right, those are also shared.
Okay.
But I'm not 100% certain about that. These look shared, because I'm pretty sure these existing resource templates are all from different sites. personable. Everybody's creating persons.
That's showing the latest changes?
Yeah, this is sort of just the browse through all the items in the site. So just refresh it every once in a while.
So does an item, what corresponds to an actual page on the eventual site then? Is that the items, or the items things that you insert into a page?
Items are things that you insert into a page.
So how do you make a page in a site then?
Yes, so if you got, go to those sites, and then add those,
notice that the menu changed. Okay,
yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, so then when you go to...
I see. Then I can add a new page. Oh, there it is. Add a new page. Done. Okay. All right, I just didn't notice that the menu changed.
It is easy to miss, I confess.
It's really easy to get pictures in here.
What's that?
It's really easy to get pictures in here. Just slapped in a URL and there it was.
Uh-huh. Yeah, this is, that's back to that core principle of quick and easy web publishing.
Yeah, I'm surprised when I click on a thumbnail that I'm not getting a larger image. Not supposed to.
So on the front end, that's going to be, I think, handled by the feed.
Oh, okay.
Not entirely.
I'm getting a map.
Not entirely certain, though.
It's just, you know, you're getting these thumbnails, and I would expect, oh, I want to see, I want to zoom in on this picture.
I've been gone less than a year, and now I'm going to remember. And
I was able to do it for one of the, for the statue of freedom.
It must just be aesthetics.
Yeah, it might be like, oh well, my notifications covered up. But there's a URL. I went to the item, and it took me to the metadata. And then if I clicked on that down there, then I see the the full size image.
Thank you.
we've got just over 10 minutes left. Do you want to keep
holding? Oh, man, this flew by. Wow.
Can we see how you get the RDF out of it then, or?
Ah, yes. That's one of the wrap-up things. Are we ready to go back into more questions and stuff like that mode? You want to keep hoping. Of course, I used to be a teacher, so I know that people are going to keep poking anyway. So yes, the that first question. Yes.
If you wanted to include a URL to something, I'm assuming when you go up to the area and the metadata where it says to add media, is it expecting a URL where you can upload media from, or not just a link? Or? I was just curious because I was just creating a dummy record for digital edition versus, and I wanted to create, and I wanted, and I was going to the metadata, and I went to the silly bit. I went to the media section because that was where it said that it had a thing for URL. And there's plenty of other ways to add that in under URL. I was just curious because when I went to URL and then put URL in it to me, it had a fatal error.
Oh dear.
Not a fatal error, but sort of a different message. What did it say?
I'm pretty sure it'll try.
It's only error
for files with a media type HTML. Oh, okay. So, yeah, it is trying to pull
it's
in.
Okay, it's trying to store it, okay, not to try to
store it. Yeah. So, yeah, I think.
That's
yeah.
What I thought it was trying to do. Okay. Not a fatal error, that's so I get fatal errors all the time when I try to render anything.
Okay, so that question about getting the RDF out. The API is this REST-based API that spits out JSON-LD. So there's no Sparkle endpoint. But if you want to grab the data, you can just go through all of the items. Or all of the other resources you want. The documentation is pretty good about telling you what all it makes available. There is one little bit of a quirk in the JSON-LD that it spits out. Hey, stop messaging me. These funny O prefixes. That is, as you might guess, O stands for Omeka.
That's the namespace.
Yeah, but it's mostly internal. Information. It's like part of the data model guts of Omeka S. And so really bears no relation to linked open data because it's almost entirely for internal use and not something that gets out in the world. But it's there in the API just because it eats its own dog food, same API in the site itself when you're a human looking at it. Same API produces the JSON-LD. So it's just sort of an artifact of Omeka's guts. Other questions, things that you discovered, curious about?
I was just trying to get to parse this JSON-LD and it gives me a syntax error, invalid JSON-LD syntax.
That's a bug report for them. No. Unless it's fixed in the newer version.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know that much. I don't read JSON-LD very well.
reportable to them as a bug, certainly. I confess I'm surprised that nobody has pounced on one of the most common head scratchers. Bunch of you chose the person, class, and this is, as you would expect, RDF class. What people often wonder is, how come I can't choose more than one class? Is that common enough in RDF? But Omeka S just says, nope, sorry.
Just one.
The data model and the relationships start just made the amount of coding too complicated for the most common use cases. So that's one of the gotchas. Only one class. Speaking of choices to keep the code base manageable, I mentioned you can import vocabularies happily. But Omeka S knows nothing about subproperties. So pulling a vocabulary that has subproperties, it all gets flattened. It doesn't retain any of those relationships between properties. Doesn't know relations like doesn't know any owl. There's no inference. Notice here again when you select a class, the properties available doesn't change. In a more ideal world, changing the class would change the default properties for editing, but that again sort of moved too close into the complications of doing some inferencing, even just internally. For that kind of work though, the resource templates are there. So that's the workaround. We're getting close to the end. Last minute. Questions, critiques, curiosities?
I haven't had time to play with anything in a while, so.
Excellent.
Thank you.
That's happy.
Yeah. Gives me a lot to think about in terms of having great metadata in their story, so.
Right. And this is.
Then I get to go talk about that in 5 minutes.
No, okay. Well, thank you all for coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.